everybody's attention, please. I was holding for a few minutes just in case we had any late arrivals because we will be dimming the lights, but I want to welcome everybody to this presentation tonight and thank you for coming. I apologize for the short notice, but we didn't find out about this till late Friday, so Donna and I were both scrambling to get these students in front of the community as fast as possible. I think there's a little confusion about what this project is. This is not a project that the city is bringing to us. This is a project from Northeastern University, and these students have come to us. This will be their senior capstone project from Northeastern University. They're very excited to be taking a look at Hanover Street and giving us the benefit of their research and their professor's experience. So we hope that they'll bring something new for the North End to consider. This won't be the last meeting, but they're on a tight schedule, so we were trying to get them in front of everybody as fast as possible. What we'll do tonight is I'll be sitting down shortly and letting them present to you. After they're finished, we'll have a period for questions and comments. I want to tell everybody that Matt Conti is taping this for NorthEndWaterfront.com. I think we'd like to leave the taping continuing during the comment and question period so that everybody in our neighborhood can hear what the feedback is and think about that. Is there anybody who has a problem with being taped? You can think about it while they give their presentation, and I'll ask again before we start the comment question period. And if you're uncomfortable, just feel free to speak up. You know, give me a little signal if you don't want to say it on tape. I'll tell Matt to cut. Okay, without any more ado, I'm going to turn this over to our project group from Northeastern University.
All right. Thank you, Stephanie. My name is Matt Walsh. I'm a senior civil engineering student at Northeastern University, accompanied by our design team here. It's Matt Ford. We have Steven Leeber, Rodrigo Alonso, Steve Curtin, and Oliver Nowalski. There's six of us here. We're going to give you guys a presentation tonight on our senior capstone project, which, to give you a little bit of background, at Northeastern, in the civil engineering program, you can choose three paths. You can choose, actually I'm gonna first tell you a little bit about the presentation software we'll be using tonight. A little bit hard to see right there, but it's called Prezi. It acts a little bit like a digital bulletin board, where we've got a bunch of ideas up here, and the path kind of allows us to navigate through this bulletin board in a way that we've put together that makes kind of the best sense. But I'd like to give you a little bit of an overview as to as to why we're here and what we're trying to accomplish. So, as I said, at Northeastern you can choose from one of three branches in the civil engineering department. You can go structural engineering, transportation engineering, and environmental engineering. About six of us have chosen the transportation engineering group, of which there are approximately 25 students that get divided into five project design teams. We happen to have six students because this project is one of the larger projects. Through a proposal process, we were selected to take on the Hanover Street project. This is a project that's of interest to our professor. And that's the only reason it was chosen. It was not proposed by the city. The professor has an interest in trying to improve Hanover Street, and he gave us that small task of doing so. And unfortunately he couldn't be here tonight, but how it works in years prior, he submits in the fall prior to the spring semester. There's capstone groups every spring. He submits requests for proposals to municipalities across Massachusetts saying, hey, is there anything our students could do for you guys that might not have the funds to take on? He is a licensed professional engineer in the state of Massachusetts, and kind of offers our skills, if you will. Again, in the past, to give you an idea of the semester timeline, we go through inventory, analysis, preliminary design, community input, and final design. Right now, as you can see, we're kind of in the preliminary design phase and getting we're about 2 weeks ahead of the community input schedule, but some of these meetings, the way they played out, it made sense for us to do that. So the things we need to consider, the needs of all users, changes needed for economic impacts, and ways to complement existing land uses, taking a look at our project as a whole. I'm not going to go through all of the projects that Capstone teams have done in the past, but they've done some pretty interesting designs, and at the end, we complete a 300 to 400 page report and a full set of design plans that actually get passed on to the communities, our community officials, to be used as they please. Some ideas have been taken and implemented, or maybe portions of the overall project get to use. So again, so Southwest Corridor path improvements, life school facilities, and this year we have teams working now in Martin's Vineyard, Blackstone, Mass, us here in Hanover Street, and I think a team in Quincy. So kind of moving on, our team real quick is structured, as I said, Dr. Daniel Dulaski, he's a professional engineer, our professor, myself, a project manager for this six-person team. We've named ourselves Essential Engineering for the sake of the project, and so you'll kind of hear us refer to that in the coming slides. And now we'll get into a little bit of our proposal for the redesign of Hanover Street. But what I really want to stress prior to getting into this is that what we've done is thrown up a bunch of ideas. We're going to talk a little bit about what we're aware of that's taking place here. And none of us live in the North End. So we're kind of new to this process. Our goal for this evening is to hear as much from you guys as possible. And what we've done is thrown out simply ideas. None of this is what we're saying we're going to do or what we're forcing on the public. We're just throwing out what we call a buffet of ideas in engineering. And hopefully this design phase will help us root out some of that with some community input. So a little bit tough to see that. I don't know if you guys see it better. But when we look at Hanover Street and we started this project proposal, we think of a couple of things. And really what we've looked at is what we call it, or what we've defined as the Hanover Street experience. We don't just look at Hanover as a throughway. We look at it, it's not a street, it's a destination. It's where people can come, they can have dinner. You want them to stay for more than just that 2 hours of dinner. You want them to spend their money here, to enjoy the atmosphere, to really understand, and there's a lot of benefits that come with that, to really get to understand the neighborhood and what it has to offer. Councilor Salo Martinez said, you know, tonight that really it's one of the most interesting streets in the country. You make a great point. People come from really everywhere to experience the North End. So, project goals. That's kind of, is that really hard to see?
Yeah.
I apologize for that, but I'll elaborate on that. Project goals, multimodal access and what we call complete streets. We really want people to access the North End with a variety of different transportation, modes of transportation, whether that's the T, whether it's bicycle, whether it's walking here. Really facilitating all modes so that our reliance on automobiles, we can decrease that as much as possible. I think we can kind of all agree a few less cars on this street would help everybody. And boost the local economy, and we really want to respect the residents of the North End, but also allow us to welcome visitors. All right, here's a better one. Project scope. So we were given a very clear project scope, the bold red line, the only two-way throughway right through the North End, Hanover Street. You're all very familiar with Hanover Street, but we've also got a little bit more in our scope when we're looking at it from a traffic flow and engineering perspective. We've got Armenter Street, Prince Street, North Bennett Ave, Salem Street, and help me out here at North Street, right? On the other parallel.
Yeah.
And bounded by Cross and Commercial. But really, when we're really looking at it, we want to take everything into consideration. We really want to focus back on what we, again, refer to as Hanover Street, the Hanover Street experience. So kind of moving on here. We'll get into a little bit of defining the problem. All right, so we defined four major issues that we see on Hanover Street. Sidewalks, narrow effective widths. This is a photograph, though a little bit dimly lit here. Matt and Steve, they're standing in between some potted plants and a trash container. You've got a truck there making a delivery. And really, there's not a lot of room for pedestrians to walk by each other. That was one of our first issues. Double parked delivery vehicles. Bet you've seen that once or twice before.
No.
Definitely an issue, even though you try trying to encourage deliveries to be made in the morning or whatnot. We just saw a couple delivery vehicles here tonight that were really messing with traffic flow. And it's definitely a major issue. Traffic congestion. Caught this guy trying to make a U-turn right in front of the commercial truck there. And again, this bottlenecks this into basically a parking lot for a couple of minutes. You have people, everybody's honking their horn. It's a great situation.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what you're doing, David. And seasonal foot traffic increase. Obviously, we see a huge increase in foot traffic in the summer here. This is a great shot outside Mike's Pastries in the summer. Got a bunch of people waiting for cannolis right there. So definitely something we want to address in our project and figure out some ways we can do that. Past project proposals. Councilor Martina, I bet you know one of these very well. The first being the pedestrian mall proposed in 2006. Here's a shot of Church Street in Burlington, Mass. Or for those of you that are local and are very familiar with it, Faneuil Hall is an example. But as some have already said, we already have a Faneuil Hall. We don't really need two of them. One-way street proposal 2011, Newberry Street. It was proposed that Hanover Street be a one-way facility. But again, as we come back to that,
Does that help?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Helps a lot. All right. So let's just go back here so you can see that there.
Yeah.
Pedestrian mall, then the one-way facility. But again, we have that, it's the only two-way facility through the North End. So making it a one-way from a traffic perspective might be a little bit difficult. Some of you have probably seen this image produced, I think, by the North End Chamber of Commerce about how they would make this a one-way facility. And some of the, al fresco dining, some of it was met with a little bit of resistance. Just kind of some of their design concepts. So we want to make sure we're aware of that in our process and really getting everything out on the table before we get into some of our design considerations. As you can see, I'll talk a little bit about the street today up there. So now what I'd like to do, I'm going to turn it over to Matt Ford here for a few minutes, and we'll kind of both work together as we walk you through some of what our team is considering. Again, these are just concepts, and we'll be here to listen to your feedback.
Thanks, Matt. So as Matt said, this is just our preliminary design. We're here tonight to really provide you with all of the buffet of ideas. We want to get your feedback on it and let you know these are things that we're considering in our ideas, but definitely not solutions. So first, I'll just give you a brief overview of the things we're going to be talking about tonight. First, we're going to be looking at the effective width of the sidewalks. Clearly, that's an issue around here, having those narrow sidewalks. We want to look to increase that. We're going to be looking at taking a seasonal approach. We've been interested in these portable sidewalks. We'll talk about it. It's a method that takes a seasonal approach to allow for higher pedestrian use in the summer and higher vehicular use in the winter. We're also going to look at the lane widths that are currently existing and looking to reallocate some of the space. We found that there are a few inefficiencies in the current design, and we'd like to look to maximize all the space available for pedestrians, for vehicles, and for all users. We'll also take a look at the commercial vehicle parking. Obviously, we saw that double parking was a problem, so we'll look to address the commercial vehicles and the valet access that's along with it. We would definitely want to make sure that pedestrians feel safe, so we're going to be looking at the crosswalk facilities. We also want to look at bicycle racks. We want to encourage bicycling in the area, and as we know, having bicycles is definitely a great thing, but we need to look at what's available for parking your bicycle and not affecting the effective width of the sidewalks. And finally, one of the most important topics in this region is resident parking. We want to make sure we don't eliminate any resident parking and make it as smooth of a process as possible. So the first thing we're going to talk about is the effective width of sidewalks and what we currently have. Here we have two pictures of the current sidewalks. You would see in the top left picture originally, showing that there's very small effective widths. We feel one of the main contributing reasons for this is due to all the furniture that's on the sidewalks. I would like to state first that we're not looking to remove any furniture completely from the region. We're just looking to relocate it. So we're looking at things such as the light posts, the trash cans, the signs that are there, and the newspaper stands. We're not looking to remove them from the street, but we're looking to move them out of the pedestrian walkway and increase the effective sidewalk width. So this bottom left photo right here shows a proposal that we're looking at. I don't know if you can see it as well, but what I'd like you to notice are these white areas right here. So what we have is existing sidewalks,
the crosswalks here, and this is the parking space. We're looking at potentially installing what we call street bulb outs. Basically, you can think of an extension of the curb out into the street, not to minimizing the parking, but also we see the advantage of this being that this could be an area where we could put some trees, where we could put the trash cans, the newspaper stands. And we think that this is really going to increase the effective sidewalk width. We're also looking at these bulb outs. If you think about where you cross the street, having this bulb out allows the pedestrian to be more visible to the driver, and that's going to increase safety in the area. So one of the things we're really looking at is, like I said, increasing the effective sidewalk width by removing some of the street furniture from the walkway and to these bulb outs. Yeah, absolutely.
I just want to point out something real quick. When we refer to effective sidewalk width, this is a great shot of it. We've got Matt and Steve up here, and you can get out there with a tape measure and you can measure the distance between the potted tree we have here and the trash can, and let's call it 4 feet. And that's our sidewalk width of actual passageway. When we say effective sidewalk width, we're referring to what you and I would be comfortable walking through. That goes from 4 feet down to 3 feet, because Matt doesn't want to walk right up against the trash can.
Yeah.
He wants to walk 6 inches off it. And same with me, when I'm walking next to him, I want to walk six inches off that tree. So just want to be clear, when we refer to effective sidewalk width, in a lot of areas, it might be as low as 2.5 to 3 feet. Even though you can get out there and measure 4 feet.
Absolutely, thank you, Matt. And so another point that we're looking for that, if you wouldn't mind going back one more time, the last thing we're looking at is the current light posts. Obviously, the lighting is very essential in the area, but we're looking at alternatives for, instead of using the standard light posts, potentially putting lights up on the street, up on the buildings. We'd still be able to get the same illumination in the area. However, we'd be able to increase that effective width that we just described and increase the amount of space available for walking.
I'm going to talk about one of our design considerations called the seasonal portable sidewalk system. And as we're looking at our issues here in Boston, we also have to consider what communities around the nation, as populations expand and people move back to the cities, a lot of cities are facing the same issue. So we've done a little bit of digging and come up with a couple solutions. One solution that's being used right now in Halifax, Nova Scotia, San Francisco, California, and New York City, New York. Where this photo is taken. This is what's called a portable sidewalk system. It is shown here with alfresco dining out on the sidewalk, but that's just one use of it. It can also be implemented where in the summer months, for approximately 4 months, you take out the on-street parking, and that is something that we'll address a little bit later. You take out the on-street parking, crews come in maybe a day, 2 days in the beginning of the summer, they install with forklifts or however, these wooden or whatever materials chosen sidewalk systems to literally double the widths of the sidewalks and really create that summer feel, that experience that we keep talking about. So I'm going to move along. I'm going to show you just another example of how this can be implemented. This might be a little tough to understand, but this is a scenario that a company designed a cafe outside and used the wooden sidewalks to bump the sidewalk out around and have the cafe there in the summer. I know the cafes meet a little bit of resistance, but we're throwing out all the ideas and what we're looking at. So we did up a sketch up here you have a building face here, existing 10-foot sidewalk, and what would be an additional 7-foot panelized portable sidewalk system that could be easily moved in and out. And in the winter, when it's cold and the residents want their parking back, we give it back to them. Just taking a look at all ideas, I'll give you a different view of it from the side. It's a little bit harder to see, but just an idea, a concept, you can kind of visualize it and understand what we're thinking about. Turn it back over to Matt for a cross-section review.
So we've thrown out a couple ideas to you guys now, and we'd like to just show you what a typical cross-section might be. So the first cross-section I'd like you to look at is actually the existing cross-section. Here we have building faces on either side, showing our two sidewalks here, and then the travel lanes. You have a northbound and southbound travel lane, as well as two parking lanes. So we're looking at currently a total curb-to-curb distance of about 39 feet. Now, there are no pavement markings distinguishing the parking and the lane and the travel lanes right now. But if you look at it, it's approximately a 12-foot travel lane on each side with 7.5 feet of parking. Now, as you all probably know, with this parking being there, there are no lines there. You typically see that people tend to park a little bit off the curb.
A lot of times you'll see that people might park 1 to 2 feet off the curb, which actually extends themselves out into the travel lane. So we think there's a little bit of an inefficiency there, that if we help guide people on where they should be parking by providing the pavement markings, they'll be more encouraged to park close to the curb. And there are a lot of studies that have shown that introducing this pavement marking will force people to move over, because they'll get out of their car, they'll see where they should be lined up, and they're going to line up the way you want them to. So here's one of our first examples of what we'd like to show you for a cross-section. This would be the summer season while portable sidewalks are installed. We're actually looking at reducing the curb-to-curb width, because as I told you, there's a little bit of inefficiency where people don't exactly know where to park. So we're looking at going from a 12-foot lane to a 10.5-foot lane with 7 feet on the sides. Now right now we're in the summer season, so you'd have that 7-foot portable sidewalk. That would be added to the existing curb, the existing sidewalk, excuse me. And because we took out those few feet in the middle, we'd be able to increase the size of the sidewalk space. As you can see here, we also removed the trash cans and the light poles, putting lights up on the buildings. This increases that effective sidewalk width and allows more users in the summer to be able to access the area. So the third cross-section I'd like to show you is what we'd be looking at for the winter months. We still have our widened sidewalk because we've decreased the curb-to-curb length. And then we're going to have two 7-foot parking lanes, as well as our 10.5-foot travel lanes. I'd like to restate one more time that the reason for having this decrease in the area is because we're going to install new pavement markings that are going to help people park next to the curb. And we feel that by moving them over that 1 to 2 feet, that's going to give you essentially the same travel lanes. So while we are physically decreasing the travel lane, you're not actually losing any space as far as how much you have to drive. So you're still going to be able to get your fire trucks through there. Your commercial vehicles are still going to be able to travel through there. Effectively, you have the same amount of travel space as you did before. We're just trying to make the area more efficient.
Yeah. I also just want to say one more thing that I failed to mention a couple minutes ago. We keep referring to Hanover Street, but our primary focus for what we call phase one of this project is Hanover Street from Cross Street to North Bennett, really the first half of Hanover Street, where you have a large number of restaurants, definitely more so than the other end. And really, it would allow us for an area, and on-street parking in that area totals roughly 85 spaces. We'll talk a little bit more in a few minutes, but we definitely want a net zero loss during the summer when we have implemented a system such as this portable sidewalk system. It really gives us a chance to test it out in a small section. Really how engineering kind of works is you know, working these in and testing an idea out in a specific area that's very controlled. So definitely that's important. And we'll talk a little bit about LEDs here. But another program that the city's working on right now.
With improving the street lights, we were looking to take the existing light posts and put lights up on the building faces. Another implementation we might be looking at is converting to LED lights. There are a lot of advantages to LED lights, and they're becoming very popular in the city. The city is actually taking an effort right now to implement LED lights because of the advantages. The main advantages they have for these, they're cheaper for use, they're longer lasting, as well as they're actually brighter than the standard light that we use today. So being cheaper for use and a longer time before you have to replace them is definitely an advantage. And clearly up in that high region, up on the buildings, you're not going to have crews going up there very often to do it. So by providing brighter lights that are cheaper, it's definitely an advantage that we'd be looking at.
And again, we want to focus on that Hanover Street feel. We don't want to lose the quality of light that's there now. We don't want to come in with a bunch of LED lights and light up a nice white Hanover Street. That's not the intention. This allows us to really actually evenly distribute the light and have a lot more control over it.
And when we say the LED lights too, there are a lot of fixtures that can be assembled on the face of the building. So we're not taking away from the ambiance of the area. We're just looking to use a more efficient light bulb itself. But the fixture, there are a lot of options. We can still keep the nice, you know, the look of the lights and keep the ambiance of the area. So another design consideration we'd like to talk to you guys about tonight is the commercial vehicle parking. Currently, we only have commercial vehicle parking available from 8 a.m. to noon. These areas are shared with residents, so after the commercial vehicles stop using it, residents are able to take it over. We feel there's a lot of inefficiencies in this area in that commercial vehicles cannot easily access those spots because the other vehicles are encroaching on the area. It's not easy to get in and out, and as we all know, we see commercial vehicles double parking on the street, which essentially shuts down one lane of traffic.
So what I'd like to show you here, we have that picture that we talked about before, the existing condition of the Dome Park vehicle. I'd like to direct your attention to this bottom right corner. This is that same design consideration we showed you earlier, but this time I'd like you to pay attention to the yellow boxed area. So our design consideration for this is to install the commercial vehicle parking at the beginning of each block. The advantage of this, which you already see in some cases, is that the commercial vehicle can enter the space without having a vehicle behind them in any case. They'll be able to pull in, not having to worry about backing up in any way. And then as I told you before, we have these white street bulb outs. So the street bulb out is actually gonna separate the commercial vehicle parking from the residential parking. That's gonna allow the commercial vehicle to get it. They're guaranteed that space, making them more encouraged to use that space. We also installed for the street bulb out a 45 degree angle on the face of it from the commercial vehicle side. So if you picture the commercial vehicle pulling in, they actually have a 45 degree angle going away from them to pull out. This is gonna allow them to pull out without ever having to back up. We feel that this is a good idea because first, if you consider a crosswalk behind it, you don't wanna have a commercial vehicle backing up into pedestrians that are crossing. There's limited visibility, it's inefficient for the drivers, and they just don't like to do it. So we wanna provide an area that commercial vehicle can pull up to the airspace, unload, and then easily pull out without ever having to back up. It's efficient for them. They'll be more encouraged to use the space, eliminating double parking, and we feel it's safer for everybody around. The other idea we have for this space, as we know, the commercial vehicle space is only from 8 a.m. to noon. And as we know around here with all the restaurants, valet parking is a big issue around here. Every restaurant wants to have valet parking. Currently, City Valet is one of the main valet parking companies around, contracted by multiple restaurants. So we'd like to standardize where the valet spots are being used. So our idea for this consideration is to take that same existing commercial vehicle space and in the afternoon and late evening, convert that to the valet stands. So once again, you'd have valet stands at the beginning of every block rather than where they are now. As you know, they take over the residential spots from 5 p.m. to 2 a.m. They put up their sign, which is honestly very hard to see sometimes because of the vehicles parked in front of them. And it makes it tough for people to see where they're supposed to go. So by standardizing this spot, we're still giving the restaurants their valet parking. The valet parking is now at the beginning of the block. It's easier for people to understand where it is, and it's easier for them to pull in. So we feel that this is a strong approach for this. We also feel that these spots could be used for taxi stands. Obviously, a lot of people are walking to the area, taking a T, maybe they want to take a cab home. So we'd like to look at dividing the space up between valet parking and taxi cab stands. We don't feel that we're gonna lose any of the residential parking because if you think about it, the valets are already taking over the residential parking in the evening. So by taking this approach, you're not going to have any mixture of residential and commercial vehicle parking. Instead, you're going to say, okay, the first two or three spaces of each block are just going to be for commercial vehicles. In the morning, they'll be the delivery trucks, and in the afternoon and late evening, you're going to have either your valet stands or your taxi cab stands.
Yeah, one other thing I like to reiterate there is those bulb outs that Matt pointed to that actually separate the commercial vehicle zones and the residential parking zones. That's a concrete, very small bulb out to delineate that, but it also allows us to put our trash cans there and any other fixtures that may be currently taking up that effective sidewalk space. So really trying to look at every single need on the street and design as effectively as possible to incorporate everybody's needs.
The other approach that we're looking at for this is currently those small signs for where commercial vehicle parking is, where valet stands are, is very difficult to see. People, especially when they're unfamiliar with the area, they pull up to that spot and they essentially have to take all of their attention away from the travel lane in order to read that small sign and see what it is. One of the approaches we're looking at is using a yellow hatched diagonal line in these spaces, designated as a commercial area. If you're just a standard driver pulling up and you're not familiar with the area, but if you see a bright yellow hatching right there, you're gonna know that's not a spot for you to be parking. So we're trying to make these spots as standard as possible and also as identifiable as possible. We want to definitely keep that segregation between residential and commercial parking and make sure everybody is aware of what's being used for. So continuing with that thought, we're going to use the same cross-section again. We'd like to look at the crosswalk facilities. Currently, we know that pavement markings fade very quickly. There's a lot of issues with accessibility of these crosswalks and the visibility. One of the key things that we've noticed on these crosswalks is if you think about not going parallel with Hanover Street, but crossing Hanover Street,
a lot of times you see a raised curve in that crosswalk. If you have a handicapped person or a mother with a stroller, it's very difficult for these for the person to cross the street safely. In order to cross this raised in order to access this curve, they're going to have to travel around to this corner where the crosswalk is parallel. There's no clear access there, which makes the person in that that wheelchair have to be on the street longer. So we definitely like to look at including making sure handicap ramp accessibility is available everywhere and improving the existing current crosswalks. Here's a cross section of it. One of the things that we're looking at is rather than using standard white paint for the crosswalks, using what we call pavers. We're looking at, if you'll notice these red spots right here, this is Prince Street and Hanover Street. We're looking at using red pavers for the crosswalks. So if you think about the filling of the crosswalk being red pavers and still being distinguished with white lines on the outside, the white lines could either be paint or white pavers. The advantage of these pavers is that while they are a little more costly up front, they last a lot longer. The color is permanent throughout the block. The color doesn't fade. As you'll see, as you all know with the white paint, that paint tends to fade very quickly, sometimes as quickly as 6 months to a year. We don't want to have to be going around every year restriping all the crosswalks to make sure pedestrian safety is available. And clearly with this, pedestrian safety is going to be one of our primary concerns because it's essential for everybody in order to travel around here.
And if anyone's ever been over to Kenmore Square, there's a lot of places in the city that are implementing this as the city upgrades the transportation facilities. But Kenmore Square, I was there the other night, great example. That red right there, it obviously wouldn't be that colored. I'm talking like a brick red. That's really not, it's very actually aesthetically appealing. So, it serves multiple purposes, but definitely useful.
And our next point that we'd like to throw out to you is the bicycle facilities. Here's two pictures of current bicycle facilities that people are using. As you all know, there are the small used once in a while on streets for bicycle facilities, but they can only accommodate one, maybe two bicycles. When a bicyclist, and these pictures were just taken last week, so this is in the winter time. People are looking for anywhere they can park their bicycle. As you can see here, one rider was using a post in order to lock their bike up. Here they were actually using the tree in order to lock their bicycle up. So we're going to be looking at implementing bike racks throughout the area in order to promote bicycle riding and to allow people to have a safe place to lock up their bike. We will be looking at some of the side streets and maybe using one of the parking spaces right before Hanover Street. If you think about a side street approaching Hanover, maybe taking one of those spaces. Doing some research, we found that one parking space can accommodate 10 bicycles. So if we could implement them through the area, it would encourage people to use their bikes, give them a safe place to lock them up, and not affect the sidewalks. We definitely want to make sure that people are utilizing the correct facilities and not using trees for bicyclist locks.
And again, we want to reiterate that we're not trying to make Hanover Street something that, you know, we're going to go through and stripe bicycle lanes on the pavement. That's not how we feel that it is in terms of bicycle facility. We just want to make it accessible by bikes. However, maybe that means a bike rack at Cross Street and one at Commercial, so people can get to the area with bikes and have a place to lock up their bikes that really doesn't detract from the area as in these scenarios here.
You talk about parking.
All right, yeah. Next we're going to talk about an item that is clearly of a lot of importance to everyone, parking facilities in the North End. This is an aerial shot. Hanover Street is right here, and I'm gonna draw a blank on the name of the wharf here.
Sergeant's
Wharf, all right, thank you. And right there, those three highlighted zones have something like about 600 parking spaces. 700 parking spaces all over. We're just studying, I'm only bringing this picture up to let you know that we're studying parking facilities, their use, the capacity of them, and whether they're fully utilized all the time. And I think really to affect change in this area, it's gonna need to incorporate everyone doing a little bit of their part. And we might be able to persuade some of these underutilized facilities to allow for a little bit of resident parking. Not sure, just something that we're looking at. We'll move down here. You can see the other end of Hanover Street. very familiar with the Greenway. As I came to Boston 5 years ago, I wasn't all that familiar with what Boston used to look like prior to the big day. I didn't realize that I actually learned being here Monday night that the North End was robbed of a few parking spaces in this project. It's something we're taking a look at and really just trying to understand the parking facilities. Parcel 7 down here, another lot over there, really understanding. We talked to a few valets on our walk up tonight and really trying to understand the peaks and when facilities are utilized or underutilized. Again, just parking ideas. Another kind of concept here that we were throwing around is really taking a look at every single available open space that we have. This is actually a model of what we have, your basketball court right outside here. This is the exact size of a basketball court. Though those are Volkswagen Beetles, those spots are actually designed for larger vehicles. That's just the only thing the computer program had. So 18 parking spots. We were having a conversation with a couple kids outside before we started this presentation tonight. Hey guys, do you play, you live around here? Yep, they lived on the side street. Do you play basketball here in the summer? And they responded, yes. I said, do you have a car? Do you drive a car? And the gentleman responded, yes. And his feedback was, I said, well, what if we developed some type of a system where we could add an additional 18 resident parking spaces just overnight from 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. And you get towed and a large fine if you're not out of there at 8 in the morning when the kids want their basketball court back. But you're not allowed to come in there until 8 o'clock at night when the kids are done. And he said, hey, I'd rather have parking at night than my basketball court for another hour until 9 o'clock at night. Just ideas we're throwing around, really concepts, but I think this design to improve here in the North End is really going to take looking at every single opportunity that we have.
Yeah, and I think the point to take away from this is that we understand that resident parking is a primary concern for everyone. It's definitely going to be on the top of our list, as sure as we don't want to take away from resident parking at all. And we did throw out the idea of the seasonal portable sidewalk, and we realized that taking that from Cross Street to North Bennett Street, that does take away some of that parking on the street. We're looking at other ways to reallocate some parking during those summer months farther away from where somebody might live. We looked at Parcel 7 over on the other side of the Greenway. So our approach is going to be that in the summer months during the nicer seasons, people are willing to park a little bit farther away from their house and walk during the night. And then we realize in the winter we can take away those seasonal sidewalks and give back the parking right next to everybody's businesses and their houses. We want to allow for the seasonal approach in that way, and that we think that we definitely understand that resident parking is essential, but we want to look at other ways to manipulate the area and basically maximize all the available space.
We were walking up Prince Street on our way here tonight, and there was a, drawing a blank on the restaurant name, but there's a couple of valet spots outside on Prince Street. If we standardize that valet area, as we talked about, Matt talked about a little earlier, there's a few more spots we can give back because they can walk, restaurant users can walk 50 to 75 feet from the corner. Everyone's going to recognize those valet zones. They're all standardized. And you can give back those on-street parking on the side streets and allow people to, restaurant owners to have their valet on the corner. I'm gonna talk just a quick bit about project schedule. That's part of my job to manage as we look at our academic semester. We started, our project was awarded in the last week of January, first week of February, after the proposal stage, and we graduate or are done this class April 18th. It's coming up fast, 2 months from Saturday. So you can see how fast our academic project moves and why we rushed these couple of meetings this week to get your input. But right now we're in week four, approaching week five. We're actually a week and a half ahead of schedule for community input, a major milestone. We have a presentation coming up on March 2nd at Northeastern. That we'll be inviting a few officials to. We have limited space. I'd love to invite everybody. But we'll be presenting for our professor as part of a major milestone for our project. So we're getting a little bit of practice tonight. And then we have spring break. Planning on taking that week off. And then moving along here, we have draft final report and plans, that red bar that you can see for weeks 8, 9, and 10.
that will be very, you know, buried in writing and AutoCAD and plans. So really looking at the end of our project, and we have a series of presentations as we close out into April. So the project moves very, very quickly, so as much input as we can get from you guys.
And I think the takeaway message there is that we are here earlier than our schedule says we should be, but that's because we recognize that this is a special area and that you guys really are the experts of the area. We understand the engineering behind it, but you guys know what's really out there. And so that's why we're here early in our preliminary design to get the feedback from you, to hear what you have to say about our ideas. You might have a different perspective than us as far as why something may or may not work, what some ideas might be. So I think that's really what the highlight of this schedule should show, is that, you know, we're here trying to get as much feedback from you guys as we can, trying to absorb what we can from your knowledge and experience of the area and incorporate that into our designs. And that's why we'll be back in a couple of weeks, and we'll be talking with everybody continuously as we continue the project.
And I'll absolutely reiterate the fact that we do produce that 300 to 400 page report. We want that to be as realistic as possible. I'd love to be able to hand it to city councilor and say, hey, maybe there's a few officials you might know that might like to read this. We will have PDF of that report at the end of the semester available for everybody's use, and the same with the plan set. So that moving on, I think that wraps it up for us. So we'll be moving into some question and answer and some discussion on that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we'll have some plans yet too, so to show if people want to walk up after.
Great. This is wonderful. We have over an hour of time. First, I want to ask the question that I posed at the beginning. Had a little time to think about it. Are we all comfortable letting Matt Conti continue to tape so that this discussion can be shared online? If there's anybody that's uncomfortable, you just give me a little sign. And for the winks and nods.
As long as he doesn't take my picture.
It's mostly focused up here, isn't it, Matt?
Yeah, I'll just keep it away.
Oh, okay.
We can leave it on, and then we can turn it off, and then we can do both.
Edit.
Okay, sounds good. I think we'll follow our usual protocol of asking people just to identify themselves, maybe which part of the neighborhood they're from. I'll ask you to wait till I call on you so we don't get a lot of people talking at once, and let's try to just give these gentlemen as much input as we can and maybe save the discussions about which is better for a later meeting. That's good for everybody? Okay, Sal, is that the first hand I see?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much for doing this. This is something that was always on my mind when it's an independent look at Hanover Street. I love to share ballet zones. I think that's very, very important. So when you go out there and you look at it, I think the locations where we put them are very important, because we have more restaurants coming looking for ballets, and I like to share ballets. So I'll be interested to see what other locations on Hanover Street that you would suggest for these ballet zones. Talk a little more about the portable sidewalks. Really interested in portable sidewalks. I heard about those in other cities. Does the city pay for these sidewalks? Are there businesses? Are they really expensive to put out there?
The cost is something that to be honest with you, I wish I had more data tonight. It's something we do an estimate towards the end of the project. But, and first I wanted to say about the location on the valet spots. Obviously, there will be some, and you do your best to not favor anybody, to really objectively, but wherever those zones are choose, there's a restaurant in front of them. Somebody benefits from that. That's something you can't avoid. But standardizing it so that everybody understands why you're standardizing it and why it makes sense to do that, so that it's fair for everybody. So I sat here the other night and I listened to the Luca argument, and it was interesting to me because I didn't understand that. I'm new to the North End, and
I'm really glad that I experienced that.
And that was not a North End argument. That was a discussion.
He attended our Munich meeting on Monday night, and we had several things on the agenda, trying to keep some time for these gentlemen to give their presentation, and thought there would be plenty of time. We were moving through the agenda just beautifully, and then all of a sudden the valet issue came up, and it went on endlessly. So it was a good thing.
Well, good
I'm sorry
for us
for you.
To see. Absolutely.
I'm sorry for them, because the time for them to present to us got narrowed, but it was a perfect segue into this, that you can see how important that issue is and how there are many opinions on it. But thank you. Go ahead.
And it's just a difficult issue, because you do have that kind of somebody gets lucky if the valet zone is in front of them. But something we want to look at and be as objective as possible when we're doing that. To come back to the, do more on that.
No, I was going to jump to the
seasonal sidewalks.
So what I was going to say is, to restate what Matt said, right now we're in the preliminary design. We're trying not to restrict our ideas to the cost, but that is definitely going to be a key concern when we move into the looking at the alternatives and the analysis of it. We're actually going to be producing an objective matrix where we identify all the critical issues that we deem necessary to identify which ideas are better than others, and cost is absolutely going to be a very important issue in that. You know, construction feasibility is clearly going to be an issue for us, as well as cost. In regards to who would be paying for it, it would probably be something that would be funded by the city. We are looking at ways to subsidize some of that cost. We talked a little bit about the alfresco dining. We are in favor right now as making sure that this area is more for pedestrian use, but we do see the option to look at a small amount of alfresco dining and potentially permitting that out to regain some of the cost that have been from there. I think as far as, I'm trying to think what the other point was, there was one other thing that I was missing.
Yeah, and again, this comes back to engineering and the real condition of the street. Implementing a system like this from a first glance, and that's where we're at right now, is a first glance. Walking around, you see the conditions of the curbs and the crumbling pavement. That's something that really may have to be entire sidewalk might have to be ripped up, replaced. You have concrete, and you know, this is, again, we're just throwing out ideas. Replacing that concrete, making in perhaps, you can see here, next slide. If you can even see that, but kind of how these systems work, you might have a groove in the 7 foot of street where those kind of just lock into place so that they're safe for pedestrians, so you don't have them moving around when people are on them. You need some kind of a system to so that it works effectively and so that they can be installed quickly and efficiently, so that we're not jamming up the street while we're doing that.
I think the other advantage of this seasonal portable sidewalk is that they are portable and that they can be temporary. So one way to offset some of the cost initially is to try a smaller space. So we presented an idea of maybe trying cross streets North Bennett, where you have a lot of restaurants in that area, a lot of people walking in the beginning of Hanover Street. But you could absolutely try a smaller space to begin with. We could maybe set up, you know, 1 month where we try this out. It can be installed and taken away in a couple days. It's a small cost to get a small area produced. So maybe we try a small thing almost as a trial run, see how that works before looking to a full-scale investment. So I think that's the advantage of this, is that it can be done at small scale. Try it, try it for a month, try it for 2 months, see if it works, and if it doesn't, take it away and try to look at other ideas.
And the great thing about panelizing this is that if we deem that we under-engineered the number of valet spaces and the number of commercial vehicle zones and there just simply isn't enough, we can go in, we can take out two of those panels and add another spot halfway through the project. We didn't permanently bring those sidewalks out so that you're stuck with what you get. That's kind of a huge advantage to this type of portable, adaptable design. So,
just one more, because I know everyone else has questions. My biggest pet peeve, and really aggravates me, is commercial vehicles that come in after 12 o'clock. So when you're out there, you're looking at the commercial parking space. Do we have enough parking from 8 o'clock to 12 o'clock? Why'd you look at that?
Okay.
And also, if you look at other cities, like I really think that if we expand it to 1 o'clock and maybe restrict commercial vehicles from the North End at a certain time, can you look at some of those issues while you're doing research?
Sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think definitely looking at the times that it's available, and then the reality is that it's going to come down to enforcement of those times.
Yeah.
And I know it's all been stated that right now, you know, the easiest approach is just to enforce everything that is already existing. That's the approach I believe that's being taken right now, is that you want to just enforce all of the regulations that are there. So enforcement is clearly going to be a key part of that. I think that as you're, if you're transitioning this area to valets and cabs, they're going to be vying for that space, so them taking it over will restrict the commercial vehicles from using that space in the late afternoon. But that's definitely a good thing to be looking at.
I think enforcement in anything that we do plays a huge role. You know, if we talked about the basketball court. People will learn pretty quickly if you park a tow truck outside the basketball court for 3 weeks, and they get towed every day at 8 o'clock. If you're not out of there, you're towed so the kids can have their basketball court back. These are just everything. Enforcement is obviously a huge part of the law and
In this neighborhood, they won't tell you if you're at a hydrant, a handicap ramp, or a crosswalk. I don't think they're going to tell you if you're in a spot that's designated for a playground.
Who does the towing right now on the street? Is it the city? No, I mean, who is supposed to do the towing in this area?
We have the Boston Transportation Department, and then we have the police who could call for a private towing company to come in and tow.
I was going to say, if you take that area of the playground, of the basketball court right now, I actually live in the Mission Hill area right now, and parking is a problem there as well. They have actually private towing companies that do deal with all the lots there. And they are very quick in responding to any car that is in an area that they shouldn't be, because they make the money. So maybe one option for something like the basketball court is, because I don't know who owns this lot right here, the community center, is that public?
City.
The city owns it. Maybe they look to outsource the parking lot right there to be enforced by a private.
And we do have some schoolyards.
Yeah, definitely.
Where you can park overnight.
I can tell you, if you get a private tow company that's responsible for an area, they want to make money. They're going to have their guy there at 7:59 ready to tow.
So you get a cut of it. The city makes a little bit of money. It's kind of, people learn pretty quick. So.
There's still more important spots that should cars that should be towed. Right?
Oh, absolutely. No,
definitely.
I was saying they'll tow you.
Something to look at and be well learned.
That's safety.
No, I have
probably safety. Yeah.
Yes.
Historia, I have three questions. First, do these changes meet the ADA standards?
The changes in the handicap?
No, the changes you're making to the sidewalks. Is it?
Again, code is definitely something we're taking a look at. These systems are being implemented in a few other cities, so we want to look at how that's lined up with the code. ADA is, again, something we're looking at as well with even the existing system. So that's a very good question.
The second question, are these LED lights battery operated?
I don't know the answer to that question.
I don't think I'd like the wiring.
Okay, yeah. I was going to say they're grid, right?
It's just regular. Yeah. It would be the same as the street lights now, only different bulbs.
Yeah, so that means they're going to have to pull it up from the buildings, and that's
going to
be a cost.
You can put like a small strip on the outside of the building. There's a few ways to do it, and we want to be able to look at the street lighting on the buildings. It's actually an idea that really helps us with the effective sidewalk width, and maybe it might add a little bit of character if done effectively. But all of these implementation and construction techniques really need to be looked at very closely, and that's a great point.
And who pays for the damage?
Who pays for
the damage to
your property?
Outer facade of the buildings.
Oh, the property owner. What happens if
so
city lights?
You're saying if we take out the city lights now and we put new city lights on the side of the building, who pays for that?
The damage.
That's awesome. I would think it would be part of our plan for if the city's paying for the lighting, the city pays for any damage to what happens during construction.
Yeah, because these buildings are old, and it's not standard construction, and they're very fragile.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. And I think that's one reason why we said, you know, we're just looking at ideas right now. That would definitely be something we'd want to look at in our objective matrix and determine if it's a good idea or not. And that's a great point that, you know, we hadn't thought about because we haven't really looked at the buildings. But I think now that we know that, we can look at it and say, okay, are these buildings really going to be able to handle putting lights on them?
And the third comment is, this basketball court out here is next to a retirement home. And the brothers are always complaining, and the priests are complaining about the noise after hours from the basketball court. So if they now have to listen to cars coming in all hours of the night, there's going to be a or what, you know, there.
There'll be less noise for cars. You already have cars going up and down the streets.
Yes, but you also have, in the north end, everything is brick, concrete, and granite. And it's like an echo chamber.
Yes, absolutely.
So you have someone clicking their car closed, clicking their car open, slamming their car doors, talking like they're out in the middle of the boondocks.
So my that's a great point. And my solution to that, and there's a lot of ways you can look at it, but we could have it simply that if people know, like the kids we were talking about outside, if people know that those 18 spots are going to become available at 8 o'clock, you close that lot at 8:30.
Well, my statement would be, if parking is such an issue around here, and it's available at 8 o'clock, how long do you think it will take before the parking is actually filled up?
And then you close it off.
I think it's going to be 8:05 before it's
8:05, and you close it off, and you can't get your car till the next morning. So
I don't know about that. It's a public area. I don't think we'd want to look at that such an abrupt decision. I really think that you're going to find that this area, those parking spaces, would be great for people that do live in the area and are spending the night getting up for work the next morning. I lived in a similar area where the parking, it was actually metered parking that was available, but it stopped at 8 p.m. and you didn't have to pay from 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. So I found that it was very convenient for me to come back from work late at night, park there overnight, get up at 6 a.m., go to work at 7:30, and be out of there before the 8 o'clock meters kicked into effect. So I think that you would see, I mean, it would definitely be something that would have to be tried, but I think you would see that those spots would fill up very quickly and wouldn't be emptied until the morning. Does that answer your question?
No.
Okay.
Yes. Hi, my name is Gail. I live on Lewis Street. Did you consider, I love this presentation and love all your ideas, but did you consider one of the scenarios of having Hanover Street one way, and another scenario of just having parking on one side of the street, nobody hit me, have parking on one side of the street only, and then the other side, where there are no cars, expand the sidewalk so it's permanently, so it's more cost effective than removing that sidewalk that you said was removable. So this way, it'd be more cost effective for our taxpayers. And that's a good idea if you could kind of like maybe draw up a scheme like that.
Absolutely, those are both.
You know, and like I'm for the one way, I don't know. You know, I just think a one-way down Hanover would really work.
And at this point, I mean, those are both great points. At this point, we are definitely looking at the one-way. It's not, if we had to prioritize, it's not our top choice at this point, but we haven't ruled anything out. Mm-hmm. As far as your point about expanding the sidewalks on one side, that's a great point.
Yeah, just parking on one side.
We're definitely looking at expanding only one side of the sidewalk. Right now, we showed a cross-section that was uniform, just for clarity, but we are definitely going to be looking at each part of the street and seeing would it benefit, not only is it cheaper that way, but would it benefit one side of the street to just expand one side? I don't know if we're ready to say that we're going to get rid of the parking, but as far as we were looking at expanding the sidewalk anyway, so say we just expanded one side of the sidewalk and not both sides, that could definitely be a cheaper method. So I think all those are great points, and those are all, hopefully, we're going to get those into our report and include those in our objective matrix. Thank you, those are great points.
And cost to the taxpayer is a huge issue for us. You know, we definitely, for academic purposes, we're not supposed to be looking at it till the end, simply because this is a project that the professor wants the best ideas out first. Don't even consider cost, go for the best ideas. But we're really making sure that everything we're researching, we are researching the cost. And if you could come up with a net zero for this portable sidewalk system where, okay, instead of the permanent sidewalk coming out on the whole street, on one side, just because you went in with that portable sidewalk system and you took it out for the winter, just the number of parking tickets they've given, you know, in the street, you almost kind of get that back from the winter by that. I'm not saying that's an issue, but we do need to look at all costs, the revenue that the city generates for tickets, and all of that offsets taxes. So definitely some great points that you've brought up, and we want to be mindful of that in the project.
Yes, I'm Mary Holland. I live at Harbor Towers. This was great. I like the idea of the streetlights, because you don't realize these little teeny things that bulk up your walking. And I very much like the idea of the portable sidewalks. It also seems very, you know, Rome, Florence, sort of very European. But in thinking of this, though, there's a lot of conversation about residential parking and how difficult it is. But also, you know, when was it during the day that people that don't live here, you know, all have the fantasy that they're going to find a space. So I think the problem is eliminating any spaces is going to be difficult. And I also want to bring up on the sidewalks. I don't know if I get the temporary ones. I don't know if that'll be changing any of the existing ones. But keeping in mind materials for people with walkers and canes and, you know,
sure.
An old little old lady.
Definitely a great point. And
but I like this very much.
Yeah, definitely. And I think part of it is the mindset that people know, like, for example, let's just take the four-month zone and talk about that as an idea.
Yeah.
People know that, okay, there's a shot, there's a chance they can find a parking spot. So you know what? They're going to circle three or four times. You're adding to that congestion. So let's say we implement it from Cross Street to North Bennett. All of a sudden, they know there's zero chance that they can get a spot from
in
North
that
Bennett to
small
Cross,
area.
In that small area. So you're going to decrease, you're actually going to decrease congestion there once the word gets out that, you know what, if you go to the North End for dinner in the summer, you're not going to find a spot in that little area. We need to look at how we offset those spaces, but it's just a mindset thing too as well. In how that works and how people are cycling looking for parking.
But also that would be, cause even on the idea of the one-way thing is, what are your other streets that you use? If you're not going down from North Bennett to Cross, you're still going to want to circle, but how do you cut over? Mm-hmm. Or if Hanover was one-way, it's not like it's Newbury-Boylston, you know,
exactly.
That clear thing. Salem is one-way, but it's really tight.
And exactly, that's why the professor highlighted our other streets as part of our scope, because he wanted us to focus on Hanover, but really understand the whole traffic flow and how that works and apply it to our coursework and research. So that's a good question. And I want to also, I just wrote down another point. You brought up a point about safety and how that plays into our design in a large way. One other thing that I don't think we touched on was emergency vehicles, because I just heard about fire the other night, and I wasn't aware of that. Help me out here, guys. The fire there, and Hogue Street. That I think some trucks had some hard time getting to the fire. That's where we really want to be mindful of those travel lane widths and how the emergency crews are responding to any problem in North Bend. So again, just want to throw that out there that we are thinking about it and how that affects the project.
Dave Kubiak, I like all your ideas as well, especially the ones that free up space for pedestrians and make it safer for pedestrians. Did you check all the dimensions versus design standards? For instance, I like the ball box, but can trucks negotiate those tighter, what seem to be tighter turns than they are today?
That will absolutely be something that we look at. Again, this was preliminary design, so just throwing out ideas, but that's going to be something that we are going to be looking at. As far as making sure the turning
lanes too, do they meet standards on all your dimensions?
We take a bunch of dimensions and we're looking at, our professor is definitely all about code and adhering to guidelines. And one of the interesting things you can do with bulb outs is not necessarily put them right across from each other. You can put, if you picture a four-way intersection, you can put them diagonally.
Yeah.
So a truck making that right turn doesn't get affected on the inner corner. But when he's making the left turn, he's got the commercial vehicle zone to swing into on the side. You may get some issues if there's a truck there, and those are things we need to look at and think about. But we're definitely taking that into consideration.
In particular, that turn from Hanover Street west onto Parmington looked really, really tight.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just as an example, take a look at that one
absolutely.
And test all the others.
And ASHTO is the regulatory board for that, for the traffic and the design there. And we will definitely be making sure we conform with all their standards. They provide very clear layouts for what is required for minimum turning radiuses for large vehicles. And we will definitely be making sure that all of the design vehicles that we incorporate, which will include your passenger vehicles, your single unit trucks, and potentially the larger, you know, fire trucks, for example, definitely need to be able to maneuver all of the turns. So anything that we produce and design, we definitely want to make sure that they conform to all of the necessary design standards.
A little bit of information on the parking areas. Not that it changes the value of what you're doing, what you're proposing. Those larger parking lots where you wanted to optimize the spaces and maybe get some residential in there at times. Just to point the
most of those were developable parcels, so these will be short-term improvements. Still very valuable, yeah. I think.
Sure.
But just so that you realize that those aren't going to be parking lots forever, it's the whole time. I've always loved the idea of joint use of space, multiple uses of space. And so the idea of putting the parking lot to this particular, I'm forgetting the name, sorry.
What's basketball
this,
court?
Yeah, what's this called on the outside?
This is the Nazzaro Center?
Right.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, who is it? So I love that idea. I would say though that at least I will fight to ensure that there's no commercialization of public open space. This is public open space for public purposes. Even then, there may be the need to go through certain regulatory processes and even legislative authority when you're taking over a park for a non-park purpose. But definitely no commercial use of those public open space areas.
And that comes back to our point of really focusing on the residents' needs around here as well. And visitors and residents, but really, some very good points.
Quick question, on Hanover Street, you said there are 85 parking spaces between those two blocks?
Between Cross and North Bennett, roughly, that's a very rough count for you, per side-ish. But that's about what we're looking at when we think of, and that includes the whole street, so there's
Because I'd be curious how many most people park on Hanover Street after 6 o'clock. Are they workers, I mean residents, if you can get a count, how many residents actually park in those small parking spots?
Another option we were talking about yesterday was maybe just getting rid of all the visitor parking in Hanover Street. Because like this happens in Newbury. There was a study done in Newbury where like about 70-80% of the traffic in the street is cars that go, like visitors go to one of the park in front of the restaurant, they don't find a parking spot, so group around. So do it 5 or 10 times. So if we make the decision and like there's absolutely no visitor parking, you want to come to the north end with your car, go to the big garage, just pay market or Proper 7 or pay for your fee. If not, come with the tea or bus or.
So I think that might work with the designated valet parking zones. To be honest.
Restaurants won't agree with that, though.
Well, I know that. The restaurants don't agree. But I think the valet parking zones,
that's
you know
great.
What I mean? So that would help them. So if you have a nice big, longer valet zones, and then you're going to have more parking for residents. Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, we can only do that if we provide the valet parking, because
then
the restaurants can complain about, like, yeah, you don't have that space, but you're definitely going to have valet.
There could be something worked in there where, I don't know how you would do it, but provided those valet spaces and someone came at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and didn't necessarily want to use that restaurant, there still might be a valet member there that they could pay their money when a visitor comes here and have them valet their car to the other parking lot. I mean, I'm just literally throwing an idea out there, but again, you just really need to consider everything and perhaps that city, finds a way they can make money off this to offset some of the other costs that we're looking at. So
it would be possible to have the valet if you were just going to roam around to the dress shops or
one
something.
One big valet.
Yeah, essentially,
valet,
why do you have to go to a restaurant to get your car valet?
Yeah, I like that. I like that a lot.
Yeah, I've been trying to get that done for years. So
yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yes.
I'm Paul Nelson. I live over on Fulton Street, and I have to say I am impressed with the ideas. It looks like a lot of them are very practical. Mm-hmm. And besides the politics that get involved,
yeah, that's
they could be. To remark and say you're a fine collection of civil engineers. I had the same college roommate for 4 years. He was a civil engineer. He wasn't working as hard as you guys were. But I was looking at this whole thing. The emphasis that I see, and I'd have you go back, and I really like the idea of whatever you could do, concentrate on cutting down on the traffic.
Mm-hmm.
You brought that out as an important point, but that strikes me as being one of the key factors in here of keeping it simple on the street.
Definitely, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a very
very a couple of low-cost answers to that. I mean, just a couple of bike racks well placed is one simple solution. That, you know, you don't get your bikes tied up on the sidewalk to a tree. That's a very effective sidewalk right there. And you get people you encourage. They start walking through, they say, oh, wow, there's a couple of bike racks here. I can take my bike from wherever I was. Or you know,
there's a lot of poles, and they could say the same thing too.
Well, we got
true,
those against the thing. They'll be gone.
No yeah. Street signs.
Oh, does Cross Street have any? Are there any bike racks anywhere? Like I'm thinking down at the in front of graffiti and our core stuff. Is there anything?
They have
there?
The rental bikes in the summer.
Oh, okay.
The hub-way system.
Just one more. When you're looking at the one-way Hanover Street, just give us which way you think would be the best way. Cross or commercial, I mean, just
absolutely.
That's a I like that, and the traffic too. Where does the traffic go? So if you do traffic counts,
and that's a big question.
Yeah.
If you make Hanover Street the one-way street, how do you access all those side streets? I mean, that's clearly an issue with one-way streets everywhere. Unless, I mean, you just pointed out that Newberry Street and Wilson is a good, is an easy fix because they run parallel with each other. Every side street has one-ways that go each direction. This is not the case here because it's developed, you know, it was designed a long time ago. So we definitely need to make sure we take into consideration those areas.
Sure.
Yeah.
One more, while I think of that, just an idea to throw out, keeping things simple on the bicycle paths. What do you think about Segways? Do you think they're going to be something that will catch on? I mean, I think it's a marvelous gadget, but it's complex.
They have the rental Segways here.
But do you see those as being part of traffic flow in the future, or? They're not on the radar.
I don't think they're cheap enough.
I haven't thought about that.
That's my first gut reaction.
Yeah.
Is that they're
cheap enough
for your average. I'm not sure, but it's a thought. I like to also point out with the bikes, we happened, Oliver and I spent 6 weeks in the Netherlands this past summer riding our bike around and studying bicycle infrastructure. And I think it comes back to this point where if change is going to come to the North End, it's going to be everybody's got to give a little bit of something.
Yeah.
And if you get all the restaurants, and again, you've all heard this before, you've worked together on things, you get some restaurants, a couple big restaurants, you get Luca, you get somebody on board, hey, you know what, prove to me you rode your bike to the North End and you get a dollar off your meal or a couple bucks. It really, some kind of encouragement programs where you'd be surprised people would be on board with helping the problem in some way, shape, or form. And that's just a random idea, but how we get people on board with helping out the whole street. And if everybody chipped in and did just a little bit of something, and you incorporated a bunch of different designs that were low cost and efficient, we'd be in the right direction. Another item, just real quick, that I wanted to mention because Rodrigo brought it up, is we look at a couple of parking facilities like I showed you on commercial there, and you brought up a good point that that's developable space. But in the meantime, there's some very low-cost lifts that could be in place. We've seen them in New York City, about $3,000 to $5,000 per lift, and we've ever seen them hydraulic car lifts. So you can park, literally you take a 60-lot space, put a lift in for X number of dollars, and immediately you've got double the number of spaces. So those are another solution we're looking at, and they pay for themselves pretty quickly, and if the lot gets turned into something else, you can sell them to the guy across the street. You know, there's just different ways of kind of bringing all concepts into our report. And our final report, hopefully, our goal is to be able to talk about everything we've looked at so that when we hand it to somebody, they can say, oh, you know what, you heard that idea at a meeting. Hey, look, it got there in the report. And so that's difficult to do, but we're hoping to get there.
Because not only do we want to throw out all these ideas, but we really want to analyze them, what's their strengths, what's their weaknesses. Because whether or not something happens with our report, we don't know. We hope that it can cause, you know, do some good for everybody around here. But I think that really by analyzing all of the options that we're proposing, that's going to be the critical part of it, and looking into everything that goes into it.
That's
I think we had a couple questions over here first.
I just wanted to say something like, I don't know, sometimes I think a lot of people forget that the North End and these buildings and streets were built over 100 years ago. They weren't built for cars. So I think people forget, they think that, you know, that they could get a parking space in front of their apartment. And these streets are narrow, and I just think people, when they move to the North End with the car, you know, they just don't realize that the suburbs were built, you know, for cars and you know, gardens and space like that, you know. So, you know, the North End is not a car, you know, place, you know. So I think people forget that.
I just want to say something about that, and that's really why we're, as we said in the beginning of the presentation, like, we don't want to see it as a street, we want to see it as a destination. So what we want is, like, residents have cars, and you got to go, you work somewhere else, and you're going to need your parking space. But we want the visitors to, don't bring your vehicle. Like, there's barely space for resident parking. Like, why should we like, create more parking for visitors? So it's really that idea of, like, this wasn't built for cars in the first place. Like, they're cars now, you know, but, like, why bring more? So, like, we want to make it a destination, not a street, and, like, start.
Well, we want to create solutions so that we're not taking away from businesses that are relying on the people that are getting here by cars for their economic.
I was just more concerned about the other residents, like, you know, I'm sorry. I was just concerned basically on how, you know, sometimes the residents are just so, you know, against anything new that takes away their parking. You know, they don't look at it, you know, like the way that the neighborhood was designed, and you know, and they should just take a step back. I see that at every single meeting I've gone to over the years, people just complain, you take one parking space away, and everyone is up in arms.
Okay, let's not try to have that discussion tonight.
Yeah.
This is the information for the
get
students.
On that.
Tina, you had your hand up.
Well, it was just a thought in terms of encouraging people to park in the lots as opposed to driving into the neighborhood. If you could, and I'm sure a lot of people like to get close to the restaurants because either they can't walk that far or whatever it is. But there are a lot of petty cabs around, you know, the guys that pedal the two-seaters. If they were stationed near the parking lots where people could jump in the petty cabs and be chauffeured right to the restaurants, it might encourage them to park outside the...
And it might take a couple of businesses encouraging it and sponsoring
those petty cabs. Advertising
on
them or whatever.
Yeah.
Are they prominent? I'm actually not sure. Are they prominent in this area?
But if they were kind of a something that you knew you could jump in to get to a restaurant,
absolutely,
it might be more attractive to
park on. And on a nice night, it would be enjoyable too.
Yeah.
Okay. Anne had her hand up, and then this gentleman, and then you. Okay.
Just one comment about the garages. You should look at the groundwater overlay district to see what parts of the North End are also subject to strict requirements.
In terms of constructing a garage?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, definitely something to take into account.
Because the North End is about half Mediterranean, and it would definitely have an impact on the structures around it. And as that woman alluded to, these buildings weren't built to code 200 years ago. So it's a big consideration to take into.
And definitely something to look at, garages, but we want to do our best to look at solutions that are lower cost, because your average parking garage space is about $30,000 as opposed to a surface lot that might run you $500 or $700 to build that. But again, those garages and the water table in the North End in all Boston is very important to look at, so that's a good point, I'm sure.
Okay, another,
I'm
sorry, this gentleman.
Hi, Jim Sprong on the University, and just from your visioning perspective, if your grade was contingent upon collaborating with 100 residents so that they would accept your proposal and go forward with it, what would you say to a resident as the benefit to them to accepting your proposal as you described it tonight?
It's a great question. And
it's for your grade now.
So I'll think about it for a couple minutes. Yeah.
Yes. Do you want to take another question?
Sure. Sure, we'll come back to you.
Okay, this lady done.
Adrienne DeSepina, on Hanover Street. I think it's a great idea what you're saying. I do, you know, love, it's the destination of Hanover Street. And also the consideration that we need people to come into the North End. And that's the reason why it becomes a destination. any thoughts of not bringing their vehicles, but what about where they can leave their vehicles and be able to come in and, like you said, have a destination where, you know, more taxi areas can bring them in. People, unfortunately, they're kind of lazy. They want to park where they want to eat.
And I think over in the Haymarket area, there are a couple of large parking stalls over there that we definitely want to look at. I'm not sure if how much they're used. I realize that valets park their cars there. I know you can park there, it's public space. So I think definitely looking at the usage there, and that might be more of a promotional thing. You know, working with some of the taxis, working with the paying cab, working with making sure that everybody's aware that you can park there for an inexpensive cost, considering rather than parking in here and valeting your car, and still have easy access to getting over here. So I think it definitely is going to be the key to it, is working with everybody and promoting the idea to understand.
Because right now, I believe it's parcel 7, and there's few of us as businesses have a stamp that they can come in and, you know, park for 2 hours for $3, you know, have a chance of shopping into the north end. But still, at that point, it's like, oh my God, it's so far away. And it really isn't.
Well, just on the same idea as the Petty Cat, I used to live in Rockport, which has another traffic problem up there. So they have a parking lot outside of town with a bus, and they encourage people to park in the parking lot outside of the town, and you know, with a small bus that brings them in and drops them off and goes around all the time, so it's not as if you're stuck there. So it's, again, if there was a lot even slightly outside of the area where people, where it was inexpensive to park perhaps, and then have a bus that would take quite a few people in and drop them, say, off Prime Street or something like that.
Yeah.
To get to them.
That's a nice idea.
Are you ready to
come
back to
this?
Come
back to that.
I was trying to make the notes.
So my first thing I'd like to say is that in this area, clearly this is a big problem. Everybody's been looking at it for several years. Clearly something needs to be done. The infrastructure is wearing out. It's getting old. It's deteriorating. And clearly we need to do something. And I think the advantage of our proposal right now is that we're taking an outsider's perspective primarily on safety. If you think about that perspective, we're taking a safety first approach. So if you think about most people here, I know, you know, have no intention of leaving the area. Their families have been here for generations. So those residents have to think about their families growing up here. We want to make sure we maintain a safe facility, both primarily for pedestrians, and making sure that the interaction between the vehicles and pedestrians is a safe environment that everybody can use. So we really want to promote the safety of everything and making sure that those families feel safe. You know, you want to make sure that your kids feel safe walking around this area. You don't want to have them worry about crossing the street. You want to make sure there's a high visibility. The vehicles understand what that pedestrians need to have a priority here. So I would say that the advantage for the local residents here is that we're taking the safety first as a priority. We don't have a biased opinion as to, you know, whose ideas are more important and what's the priority. Is it residents that are more important? Is it businesses? We're trying to take an unbiased approach from an outsider's perspective with a little bit of engineering involved into it. So I think that would be our approach to that.
That's good. Good job.
So what would you give him?
I'd give him an A.
Now you'd rather take that?
Just like to say one other thing. If you think about the concept of, I think just to piggyback on your thoughts, the concept of an airport. You go, it's a destination. You're going there to go on a plane trip, but you're going there for business, pleasure, etc., much the same as Hanover Street. But there are rules, right? You can't just go park here or park at the. Everything's like a floor. You go in, you drop your, you park your car here. If that lot's full, you go park your car somewhere else. If you want to get a taxi, you have to go stand here. Do you see that type of city planning in the other areas that you've been in, where we're not saying you have to make it one way, but just the whole idea of, you know, there are rules. If you want to go to dinner here, you have to go park here. And as long as you know what you have to put, you know, go through to go to dinner, you got to plan 5-10 minutes to walk, then that's what you do. Right now, I think people are saying, and I forgot about that, you do. You'll take two or three spins around, just like we do when we try to park at night. You'll take, okay, this is my lucky turn, you know. But if you say you can't go down there to park, you have to park at Haymarket. You've made the decision, right? You probably saved the person a half hour.
I love that mindset, because I love the idea of telling people, of implementing a plan that tries something for a little while and says,
All right, we're going to let them know that there is no parking from North Bennett to Cross. There's no chance. So whether you circle 3 times or 10 times, you can't do it. So you're not going to waste your time. And really, that's just a phenomenal point. I mean, where we were at in the Netherlands, they actually, in the 70s, the downtown area of the little town we were in was a car park facility. And as there got to be too many cars, they just started to close off the area from cars and said, people, figure out a way to not figure it out. And really, as you kind of implement changes, you need to go move slowly. You know, everybody's got to be introduced to it.
But you have the valet, you have maybe a cab stand or something, so you've got access here. But you can't bring your car on Hanover if you want to go to dinner there. You park somewhere else. It's not available.
And I think the key to it, and one of the things that Dr. Dulaski, our professor, really promotes is the idea of recognizability. You want to make sure that people can look at that road, look at that area, and recognize exactly what it's intended to be used for. You shouldn't need all of this, the little signs telling people what to do. They should be able to look at an area and recognize what they should be doing there and where it's appropriate to be parking for valets. So I think that's going to be the approach that we take in this, and that's something that our classes have always promoted, is making areas recognizable for all users.
And one of the things I like to come back to, you know, for what you were saying in terms of aesthetic appeal, you were asked what are the residents going to get out of it? Aesthetic appeal, again, another item to that is cost, you know. Repainting sidewalks, crosswalks isn't cheap, all right? But if you spend a little bit more money up front, if everybody pitches in somehow, up front, a one-time, one-year cost of us going in, we put pavers in crosswalks. You don't have to repave that for 12, 15 years. That's all those years that you saved on the maintenance. So maintenance is another big issue that we really want to look at. So you have the safety aspect of redoing those crosswalks so they're safe for all users. You have the aesthetic appeal of it. It looks a lot better than crumbling pavement and you know, cracking concrete on the sidewalks. And then you also have the cost factor of it too. So a lot of benefits coming into play there that I think we can offer to residents of the North End in improving the neighborhood and the European feel that we want to get back to.
I think we had a couple questions.
Okay. Carol, the North End. When's the next meeting so we can have more residents that live in the North End? Not on the outside.
That's a great question.
That's a great question. So yeah. I have to ask Donna and Stephanie.
We're working on it.
From our.
We are. So we'll have to work with them on their availability.
And have you decided if you're going to unify French Street and Salem Street also? Or just cannabis?
One at a time.
Yeah, I'd love to do the whole thing. But again, for our the duration that we have, no matter what, we still have to do our projects because we all have to get degrees in 2 months. So I really want to graduate. So, but that being said, we love this idea. We competed very, very heavily for this project. And we love the idea that it's not just a homework assignment. It's really something, get out there, get involved in the community, and try to produce a product that means something, that you didn't leave Northeastern and just that got put on a shelf to someone else. We want to give you something at the end that means something. You know, whether you incorporate 20% of the plans or 100% of the plans, at least you did something. So really, we'll do our best to take a look at Salem Street. We did a walkthrough with our professor about a week ago, and we came down here expecting to walk up and down Hanover Street a bunch of times, and he walked us on Hanover Street for about 5 minutes and then took us around to Salem and all the side streets, and he said, really, I want you to take a look at these. So definitely in our scope, and if we don't address it, we'll have other problems on our hands. So we really definitely want to have a focus on those other streets.
Getting back to the meeting issue, are you still planning to come to the ZLC meeting next week? Is that?
Well, I think we ought to talk about, it would be quickly after this meeting, talk about the value of doing and the time that we have.
I think next week is going to be real tough on our academic schedule.
Okay.
Just to, I can throw that right out there up front. But we can talk a little bit more about, we'll definitely have another couple of meetings. So.
In terms of us, March 2nd is a big date for us. We're having presentations at our school, and we're going to invite our professor said 6 to 8 people, because all the groups will actually be presenting their projects. Just kind of give an update, 50%, so to speak, kind of project presentation, and to give feedback on it. So I think on the March 2nd, we'll definitely be asking, you know, a few people to come in and listen to the project and give some more feedback.
And relay back to everybody else.
And I think after that, we can definitely, if there is time, we can try to set up a...
So what what would be best for your schedule is something after March the 2nd in
that's
terms of coming back here for a big neighborhood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And at that point, hopefully we have more done. I think we'd like to work on a little more, too, and present more structured ideas.
If you could give us some ideas of dates that you'd like, and then we can work on what's feasible so we can get a lot of people here rather than have you go to
Small meetings. I'm so much more for not doing five at the same presentation.
If you get to one of us as quickly as possible with proposed dates, and we can work on trying to get it out.
Sure.
And then really advertise it to the residents.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that'd be
get more people here.
Definitely.
Tonight we were just trying to accommodate as quickly as possible so they could get some input as they proceed into the next phase.
There's a great. But what a problem here is, I remember going to a meeting of Public Works about cleaning streets, and they didn't have enough money to put minimum wage workers to clean the gutters, and then they need to get those extensions, store them, build them. You know, we agree to everything, I think, but it's just, it goes to the hall with this.
I don't think this is something that's going to happen next year. There's no way that can happen. That's not the way it works.
You might put
but just to make that point, this is something that, you know, we're proposing these ideas now. We're going to be handing this over, this PDF. I think in a few years, as the infrastructure continues to deteriorate, eventually people get an ultimatum that something has to happen, and eventually money's going to have to be spent. How much money, we don't know. But there will come a point where things just won't be adequate. Facilities won't meet the user's needs. And at that point, when you reach that rock bottom, so to speak, they're going to have to do something. Unfortunately, that's the way the system works.
Yeah, if time permits, it would be really helpful. I know that you're supposed to wait to the end of the project to get the cost factor, but every cost obviously is so critical there. But I know there are other communities. I'm trying to think if it's in Burlington, Vermont, or where they have implemented the lights on the buildings. I'm not sure where it is, but I know I've seen it. And if you could just give us some communities that have done it, something the city can look at in more depth, how they did it, how they implemented it, who absorbed the cost.
Exactly, because they're coming out here to do LED. Lights.
Yeah. Right now.
Maybe that's something you
say. But they're putting light bulbs in existing fixtures.
Yeah.
That's right.
We'll save
They're just putting LED light bulbs in existing fixtures. They're not coming and doing any major.
Okay.
So that's really critical. And I know it's been done in other communities. So if you could get us some ideas of what communities have done it and how they've done it successfully.
So Salem Street, there's a capital plan for Salem Street once they do the sewer line. Going there, doing new sidewalks and the lighting.
And they're resurfacing it, correct?
Yeah, so that's a nice opportunity. Might be a nice pedestrian mall, I don't know.
Yeah.
We should look at that.
Sure.
Because the lighting they'd be doing would be just a typical street.
Yeah.
I have another question about lights on the building. If the light is on the building, is that going to move the light
out?
Is it still going to be as the standing light is on the sidewalk?
Doesn't necessarily, we need to look at the illumination factor.
Yeah.
So we're going to need to look at
the residents living on the
I think the thing with the fixture is you'll be able to angle that fixture to project the light in the direction you want. So you if you picture that this was the building, you're not going to have the light shining straight down here. It's going to be angled out towards the street. So I think that the fixtures can definitely, direct which way the light is going.
The great part of that is how controllable that light really is, as opposed to just throwing a bulb out there.
Yeah.
You really get a nice light spot under it and you can't control anything else.
In reality, you would actually get, as far as in the nighttime, I know with those typical street lights, you actually get more light shining in because it illuminates in all directions. This would actually, in theory, go the other way, and that you'd actually have less going in because it would be directed down towards the street.
Huh. I think the other thing would be great is to keep thinking of creative ways to move people around the city, like you were talking about what's going on in Rockport and up in Maine and the Gunquit Wells, Kennebunkport area. They use the trolley system a lot to get people around, and it gets them to a lot of businesses, not just restaurants. And it's an enjoyable thing. It's very inexpensive, and people get picked up at lots just like in Rockport. And it's a fun thing, too, and it goes all summer long, and that really helps with the congestion up there. So anything that we could do that would be creative to get people to move from these parking lots. Because Dave's got a very good point. Some of these lots are going to be built someday, so we don't want to just rely on them.
You're going to meet more and more people living downtown.
We're losing more and more of these lots to development.
Yeah, more people coming.
Yeah.
That's a great point. Yeah, I think that's definitely something that should be looked at now incorporating. And I love that trolley system allowing people to maneuver through the city easily,
providing easy access from those parking lots.
Very effective.
And that's a great opportunity.
Yeah, very effective.
And it's a fun thing too to,
yes,
for people to be
oh,
on a
fun
trolley.
Yeah.
The kids will love it.
Yeah.
So the parents will probably want to do it all the time.
So it's not considered a burden.
Yeah, it's better than a bus. And trolleys,
yeah,
would be a lot of fun.
Yeah, that seasonal approach is huge for us too. You know, you're not gonna, obviously you're not gonna have the trolley in the winter, but there's less foot traffic. Really, that summer focus. I think a lot of these solutions that may have been proposed in the past were looking for, you know, a one size fits all,
yeah,
solution. And I don't know if that's what you can do in this scenario. So
I think one of the main problems is not even people coming to and out there in their own cars, but taxi cabs. I mean, you could look down the street from one corner, and they're all cabs. And they don't pull over to pick up. They do have their business in the middle of the street. No one pulls over. And cabs are, I mean, if they could come up with cab stands on each end of Hanover Street with the petty cabs or a trolley, no cabs on Hanover Street, that would eliminate so much.
Yeah.
And limos. But
yeah, they're the ones
that cabs are
park, so
a mess. Cabs are they're a big problem.
Well, I'll speak up as somebody who occasionally in bad weather takes the cab home. If there are no cabs allowed on Hanover Street,
I kind of like that.
I can't get the cab home,
yeah,
because,
yeah,
there's no other way to get to where I live and to come up that tail end of Hanover,
yeah,
and onto Charter.
The valet cab station, that comes back to that point about how they're, you know, periodically,
yeah,
set up through the whole corridor so that they, you know, it's very standardized and people know, all right, if I got to get a cab, you know, near campus,
where I go.
We have a point near campus where,
yeah,
everybody knows near this market there's like always five cabs lined up, so everybody just goes there. They don't even bother flagging them on the street.
With the petty cabs next to those cabs to take them where they want to go.
Have you ever studied Firenze in Italy? It's a city that, it's a walking city. Cars are not allowed there, so if you get into the station, like we had the train station over here, they are just cabs aligned and they just take you back and take you right out. So the city, it's a huge city in itself, no cars are allowed, just pedestrians and cabs. Take, you know, they'll drop you off and they'll come and take them and that's it. And yet, it's surviving, it's doing fantastic. That's another way that.
Yeah, no. A lot of things to look at is, you know.
I think the challenge there is the mentality.
Yes.
That's going to be the key. I mean,
yeah,
I think those systems can work great. It's implementing those systems,
yeah,
and that process, that change process. That's always the problem with any new bold idea is the change. That's what.
But any
that's
change
really
is
going to
be, you know, offset because people don't like changes.
But you can't close Hanover Street because people, if you come home 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock at night, you want to park your car, you can, you need,
yeah,
Hanover Street to get,
yeah,
to certain streets.
To, yeah.
So that's why I like the one way from Commercial to Cross. And, you know, you can, all the streets, they can get onto Hanover from Little Prince, or get on from Prince, and you can get off at Fleet, on North Bennett. You know, one way, I think, is a very important thing, a good thing to look at.
But what's that? What kind of load is that going to put on Salem for North?
From down Salem Street, there's no way you could come up to the North End other than, well, Prince.
No, but I mean, if Hanover Street is one way,
no,
Salem is the obvious other one way. It doesn't go all the way through.
It doesn't go all the way through.
I can tell you because I walk up Salem to go home frequently, and I have to be careful that nobody's making an illegal right on the Charter to cut down henchmen, because a lot of people do that.
Yes.
Well,
yeah. I have stopped those tourists from getting hit by cars because they're not paying attention. They don't expect it.
I think with making Hanover one-way street,
thanks,
it's not as simple as easy as making Hanover one-way street. You clearly have to look at it as a whole and making sure that the whole system functions and there aren't any stalls.
I think with that, in fairness to Bob, we should end here and thank each other.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.